Hello to all. Today let's see iBanking. So as we all know, iBanking is not the place where only the I is kept. So let's see what it is actually. So it is a non-profit community organization which deals with the collection, storage, distribution of cornea for the purpose of corneal grafting, research and supply of the other five tissues for the other purposes. What are the functions of an iBank? So, promotion, registration, tissue retrieval, tissue processing, tissue evaluation, serological testing, tissue distribution, research activities for the improvement in preservation methodology, corneal substitution, utilization of the other components of the eye. So, what are the other uses of the iBank? Donated sclera can be used for glaucoma, oculoplastic and retinal surgeries. Human amniotic membrane can be used for ocular surface procedures. Fair and equitable distribution of transplantable tissues to corneal surgeons according to waiting list. So, what are the steps of eye donation? First one, donor selection. Next one, tissue retrieval, corneal examination, tissue transportation, storage of corneal tissue and the distribution. So let's see one by one what it is. Donor selection. So age of donor, age above 70 is mostly avoided. So when the donor is the donor's age is above 70, it is mostly avoided. Then cornea of infants and children are also not used for keratoplasty. Then medical histories also has to be reviewed. Medical history of the donor. So iBanks must have consistent work policies for the examination and documentation of donors available. So the person who is donating, that person's medical records, medical history has to be checked, and the cause of death, then medications has to be checked, lab reports also has to be checked. Then third one, that is in the donor selection, legal consent should be taken if consented donor meets the medical and social history screening criteria. When the consented donor have all the history, like there is no any defects in the cornea, then the person can be selected as a donor. Then physical assessment reveals up like there is no contraindication to donate. Then only we can select a donor. Then acquisition of donor tissue can be carried out. After that, this then we can also acquire a donor tissue. Next one, serology testing. Then preparation of the donor. That is povidone iodine 1-5% for 1-2 minutes plus good stream of balanced saline. Then what are the contraindications for the use of donor tissue for keratoplasty? So death of, when the patient is having the known case, like death of unknown cause, the why the patient dies, when we don't know about the cause, then we cannot take the tissue for keratoplasty. Then death from central nervous system disease of unestablished diagnosis. Then Creutzfeldt Jakob disease, subacute sclerosing panencephalitis, progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, congenital rubella, Reye's syndrome, active encephalitis and septicemia, active bacterial or fungal endocarditis, active viral hepatitis, rabies, active leukemias and active lymphomas, high risk for or HIV infection, hepatitis B and C, retinoblastoma, malignant tumors of the eyes and active ocular inflammation, congenital or acute disorders of the eye, prior intraocular surgery or anterior segment surgery. In that cases, the patient cannot donate the for the keratoplasty. So next we will see the tissue retrieval. So that is enucleation, that is surgical removal of the whole eye has done. Then by in situ corneoscleral excision, also globe also is retained in the orbit. So next, corneal evaluation. So let's see how it is done. That is we have examine of the corneas in situ. then simple pen light examination and slip lamp microscopy to detect epithelial defects, any drying, erosion, sloughing is the, then corneal edema with associated haze, abnormal corneal shape, then blood or cloudiness in the anterior chamber, then corneal scars or infiltrates, and any signs of conjunctivitis and discharge. It has to be evaluated after retrieving the tissue. So next we have to see the storage methods. After retrieving the cornea, how it has to be stored. So there are so many methods of storage. So let's see how it has to be stored, like moist chamber storage. In this method, this is sealed chamber with saline and antimicrobial solution. It is placed at 4 degrees Celsius. Here it can be kept up to 24 hours only. If it is for long time, it cannot be kept in this moist chamber storage because corneal stromal edema and limited corneal stromal edema will come, then limited period storage period. So next we'll see the hypothermic corneal storage. This is McCarry and Kaufman medium, MK medium it is called. Added dextrose as an osmotic solution. This is viability 2 to 3 days. Suppose in case of MK formulation, add HEPS and buffer and gentamicin. This is viability period for 4 days. Here it can be corneal can be stored for 4 days. So next one, K solution. In that K solution, that is MK formulation plus 2.5 chondroitin sulfate. So here to extend the corneoscleral storage period up to 7 to 10 days. With the MK solution, the MK formulation, if we are adding 2.5% chondroitin sulfate, then we can extend the corneoscleral storage period up to 7 to 10 days. What is the disadvantage keeping like this? Corneal swelling can happen. Next one, Dexol and Aptisol. In that solution, dextrose to K solution. If we add that to K solution, then storage period maximum up to 14 days. So next we will see the normothermic storage system. Here what we can do, organ culture, incubated at room temperature in nutrient medium, that is storage period for 30 days we can keep in this normothermic storage system. Glass bottle containing 100 ml of minimum essential medium, Earl's salt solution, antimicrobial agents. Cultured bottle is closed and incubated in dry and at 31 to 37 degree Celsius. So let's see the uses of donated eyes. So what are the uses of donated eyes? Corneal transplantation, emergency patching, medical education and research. For these purposes, the donated eyes are used. So next we'll see the eye bank organization. So eye bank organization is a three-tier organization, an integrated system involving a three-tier community eye banking pyramid based on the infrastructure and manpower at all levels. So the three tiers proposed were eye donation centers. Here we see the down part, that is 2000 eye donation centers. Then there is 45 eye banks and 5 eye bank training centers are there. So this is the three-tier organization. So in the eye banking training centers, what they are doing? That is 5 eye banking training centers. They are responsible for tissue harvesting, processing and distribution. Then creating public awareness, training and skill upgradation of eye banking personnel. So next we'll see the about eye banks. This is a middle tier would comprise of a strong network of 45 eye banks. These eye banks would be closely linked with 2000 eye donation centers. It's like eye donation centers ratio of 1:50 suggested, each of which would cater to a population ranging from 50,000 to 1 lakh people. So next we will see who are the eye bank personnels. Eye bank in charge, eye bank technician, clerk cum storekeeper, medical social worker, public relation officer, then driver cum projectionist. So we will see the general supplies. Donor information sheet, consent forms should be there, pen light for grass examination of eyes, container with water, ice and special foam to transport the tissue, supplies for blood collection, non-sterile gloves, broad spectrum antibiotic solution should be there. For eye protection, safety goggles, shoe covers should be there. Disinfectant solution, eye caps, prosthesis, and biohazard disposable bag, gauze and cotton pads. Then also there is a two small two stainless containers for gauze pads soaked in 70% alcohol in one and 5% betadine in the other. So next, autoclaved and sterile materials. What are the, you know, a double hold drape, protective biohazard apparel, surgical gown, preferably moisture, cap, mask, etc. Then cotton tip applicators or hemostats to open the eyes. Sterile balanced salt solution or 9.9% of sterile saline to irrigate the eyes. Then sterile gloves should be there. Then 8 to 10 pieces of gauze. Then all instruments of enucleation has to be there. And for corneal excision, like what are the instruments used for enucleation procedure and a corneal excision, should be autoclaved and has to be kept. Blood samples are taken from the donor that is serologically tested for HIV, hepatitis B and hepatitis C virus. So eye donation centers, what they are doing: publicity of the voluntary donation, then registration, arrangement for the collection of the eye after death, then processing, packing and transportation of the collected eye to the attached eye bank. So next we'll see the blind population, that is in the world, that is about 40 million people are there. Then in India, more than 50 million are affected in blindness. Then corneally blind are 4.6 million. So what are the legal aspects in transplanting eye? Under the Transplantation of Human Organs Act, the qualification of doctors permitted to perform enucleation has been reduced from MS ophthalmology to MBBS. So when there is an urgent, when there is an emergency, the when the patient dies, when the patient is concerned for eye donation, then there is no need of expecting for MS ophthalmology. If there is an MBBS, then they can do the enucleation, that is surgical eye removal. Then eye donation in India always is decided by the donor's surviving relatives. Though the donor is giving consent for that, here in India, donor's relatives are has to decide the about the eye donation. Enucleating doctors also have to legally obtain a written consent from the relatives of the patient, like donor, before they actually remove the eyes, so that there will not be any problems in future. So thank you all. If you have any doubts, then you can ask me in the comments. So thank you.